So I'm not sure I believe that. He was one of the ones that was doing the calculation. I'm not sure I believe it, because he had some simplified models of nerve excitability. Some of you that have been sitting in my lectures know what is a phase plane, okay? Here was Fitzhugh's first phase plane. A prediction from the phase plane is that there is not a strict voltage threshold. That is, the amplitude of the response is a continuous function of the stimulus strength. It's not discontinuous, okay? So he said, I think there's something wrong in the Hodgkin-Huxley model in the code. So they went into the code. They indeed found the possibility of dividing by zero somewhere. It didn't happen very often, but it created something that felt like a real threshold. So his little simple model revealed something fundamentally important about the threshold of excitability. Here's a statement. Here is Hodgkin's description about Huxley's hand crank calculator. Okay? Huxley began a slow word. Manually cranked the calculator with numbers entered by a set of adjusting levers, rotated by hand crank. Output was a line of digits on the wheels to be read and transcribed to paper. And he was integrating differential equations, so he had to take very tiny time steps. Okay. Tabular records of the rate and state variables were entered into the levers, transcribed from dials, da-da-da-da-da. Okay. That it could be done in 8 hours is astonishing. Okay. So early computations, by the late 50s, some people were using analog computers. Okay. The vacuum tubes were like transistors these days, using analog computers. And Dick Fitzhugh used analog a lot. It was almost like real time compared to a digital computer. If you were using a digital computer, you'd punch a bunch of cards out. Each card about this big contained a typed line with holes in it. You'd have to type out every card, okay? And then you'd take that deck of cards, give it to the guy who ran the computer, and they would run your computer program. So it was a slow process. But an analog computer was like instantaneous. You tune the dial, change a parameter, tune the dial, and up it comes on the oscilloscope. So that's what Fitzhugh was using a lot, was this analog computer. Moore had one in Duke, but then he got a digital computer. Early 60s, then we were finally getting access to large mainframe computers. I remember being a summer student at the time. 1964, I was a summer student in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, which was another place where people had worked on the Manhattan Project. Now, it was a big government lab. And we had an IBM 7090. That was the state of the art in 1964. How many memory locations did it have? 32,768 memory locations, okay? So my job one summer was to program up an algorithm for solving the eigenvalue problem of a square matrix. We wanted to do the biggest matrix that nobody had done before. This matrix was 235 by 235. It was an accomplishment. All right. Okay, turn around. At NYU, they had the CDC 6600, then it was 1 megaflop. Seymour Cray left CD. These were the fastest computers, the supercomputer of the mid-60s. Seymour Cray left CDC in 1968 to found the Cray Company and create supercomputers. Okay, so that was in the mid-70s and so on, when the Cray computers, we saw pictures of the Cray computers and advertised and stuff. This was hot stuff, okay? Now we have, these were gigaflops, okay? 10 to the 9th. Today, the blue gene computer is at what teraflops, 10 to the 12th, this is 10 to the 9th, in a period of about 20 years or so, 30 years, okay? Oh yeah, this is something I want to tell you. In 1968, Fitzhugh was making movies of the solution to Hodgkin-Huxley-like equations, his simplified model, for propagation down an axon. So this is, you stimulate locally, starts an action potential, propagates down the axon. Some phenomena, two action potentials coming at each other annihilate each other. They do not pass through each other like water waves or like solitons in physics. They come together, annihilate. Okay, because each one of them sees the refractoriness in the wake of the other action potential. All right, so Fitzhugh made a movie, and you can find this movie on this website, Scholarpedia. I had it digitized. It was a 16 millimeter movie. How did they do it back in those days? They didn't have computer animation. So he solved the equations for the cable, incrementing slowly in time, dump-da-dump-da-dump. Every snapshot in time was saved in the computer memory. And then the guy from the NIH audiovisual lab came, set up his 16 millimeter camera, and each snapshot was put on the lab oscilloscope. Snap a picture, snap a picture, snap a picture. 22-minute movie he made, okay? It has sound in it and animation, kind of like one of these movies you heard when you were in elementary school. You know, science movies? Now we see this physical phenomena happening, right? This kind of voice that you've all heard. It's great, though. It's really fun to watch this movie. So what do I want? I had the pleasure to work with Dick Fitzhugh because I was at the NIH for part of my career. And in the early 80s, we were interested in behavior that looked like this. This is called bursting rhythm in a neuron. There's a sequence of action potentials, a quiet period, a sequence of action potentials, a quiet period. And so I had never used an analog computer, but Dick Fitzhugh says, let's go in and use the analog computer. So we did that for a while. But this kind of solution to this set of three nonlinear differential equations is kind of sensitive. So in trying to understand the model, we didn't get enough reproducibility. So we went to the digital computer for accuracy. But I was pleased to have been involved with Dick Fitzhugh back then. So this was in the early 80s. By that time, we had remote computing, okay? We had our mainframe computer. We had some kind of ugly-looking little monitor in front of us. It looked like an oscilloscope. It was green. It was like a big green eye looking at you. And it was a Tektronix display screen, okay? That was in the early 80s. And there was a program at the NIH called MLAB, which was designed for people that wanted to interactively fit models to data. So the program was incredibly interactive. You'd put your equations into the program, differential equations, and then you'd just say, run, and it would solve the differential equation. You'd say plot, and you could look at it. You could immediately go back and forth, back and forth. It was so different than running a batch job where you had to put in a set of simulations and then come back and look at all the data. This program, MATLAB, was sort of the inspiration for another program that many people use now called XPP later on. Okay. So let me say a little bit about this computation. Are we getting tired? Are we okay? How long have we been going?
I suppose maybe we take 2 minutes for small break and continue.
Okay.
Because I think they are just shy and not stand up for taking.
Okay, let's take a break. Nagumo was working separately, independently with Japan.
He was organizer. Someone come here. Someone organizer. Viewer.
Понятно?
No organizer here. Ah, I know.
I don't know.
We have an expedition to the water closet. Nagumo
was
in the
I mean, he was a powerful guy, but he was interested in mixing. So he made electronic based on non-linear circuits for a gold accumulation that was cubic. It was a tunnel diode. Okay? And then he built a nerve membrane like around it, with capacitance, and then make it the feedback and created a nerve membrane. So these guys never worked together. Okay, but Nagumo, but the equations for Nagumo's circuit were confused equations. So he finally came to the NIH, and they talked and all that stuff. I called it the Nagumo model. When I was I was the first to call it to New York in the early 70s. Right, sigmoid. Yeah, Boltzmann. I don't think you could just, if you were to get a particular
Кроме тайны. Брюки при наличии рук стираются. Не только в дыре.
Так интересно.
Вот оружие.
Туда, да. Некоторым пиво, некоторым квас. Ну что, нельзя было?
Не, можно, как бы. Нужно. Очень просто интересно. То
Okay, so I'm gonna pick up again. I'll try something now. Let me ask. I told you about this accent. This is a cable. The differential equation that describes the propagation along this distributed cable is a partial differential equation, okay? It's not just an ordinary differential. It's a partial differential equation. It looks like a diffusion equation. It has a second derivative in x and a first derivative in time. It looks like a diffusion equation. So how is Huxley going to compute the propagation speed? Okay, so he's going to make the simplifying assumption that a traveling wave exists. What is a traveling wave? A traveling wave is a function that depends on x and t in a special way. X plus ct, where c is the speed. So at, if you think about the profile as a function of x, and as time goes up, the profile just shifts. The profile just shifts in time. Same spatial profile, it just moves in time with speed c. So that is a function of one variable, z. The variable is x plus ct. So now, instead of having a partial differential equation, the space derivative becomes just a simple derivative. The time derivative becomes just one derivative of one variable. The speed c appears as a parameter. Okay? So you want to find a solution to this nonlinear equation, and you want to find the speed. The nerve axon should have a unique speed. Okay? Axon has a unique speed. So, okay, so you've reduced it to a ordinary differential equation, but you don't know the speed. You know that the action potential lives in some phase space. There's a rest point. What you want is a solution that comes out of the rest point, goes around after some long time, and comes back to the rest point. That's that shape. Comes out of the rest, goes around, and goes back to rest. So, you know the way it comes out. That's a math thing. You know the way it comes out. You estimate the speed, you start going. Well, if it doesn't come back around to hit this ingoing surface, forget about it. It's going to go up to infinity or go down to minus infinity. Okay? So you get so far, things diverge, you have to estimate the speed again until it goes down. Estimate the speed, goes up, goes down. You keep refining the speed estimate. That's what takes so long till you can work yourself through the action. Okay. This is the picture of that geometry. A rest point, there's an outgoing direction, a unique outgoing direction from the rest point, and a surface that comes back in. And you want the solution to go out and come back in. That's it. So I said he used this, yes, this technique of iterating the speed. Well, surprisingly, these guys were smart, okay? These guys knew their maths, as they would say in England, right? He found another solution, a second solution at a slower speed and smaller amplitude. He says, we've never seen that. We've never seen that. That's got to be an unstable solution to the partial differential equation. It's a traveling wave, all right. It's got a constant velocity, but it's unstable. That was Huxley's conjecture, 1959. Okay. So here's his... here is the traveling wave solution computed on the table. These guys, Cooley and Dodge, 1966, found them also. Fast traveling wave, slow traveling wave. This is a parameter that represents a drug you would put on the nerve model. If you put on too much drug, no more traveling wave. Okay? This is Cooley and Dodge, 1966. Who's heard of the fast Fourier transform? Fast Fourier transform. The Cooley-Tukey algorithm. That's Cooley. He got involved in nerve action potential computations at IBM because there were some people working on neurophysiology and models. Fred Dodge. Okay. This was my PhD. My PhD was, I'm sorry, you gotta hear about this, okay. My PhD problem was to look at a simplified model to find those two speeds and to prove that the slow one was unstable. So we used a simplified model. It's a Fitzhugh-Nagumo-like model, cable equation, but instead of using a cubic for f of v, we used a piecewise linear. So this meant the equation had constant coefficients. And you could solve the equation in pieces and then patch the pieces together every time the voltage went above that critical level. So I could construct an action potential like that pretty easily by solving some algebraic equation for the speed. Okay? And here are the speeds as a function of some parameter, a fast wave and a slow wave, until the temperature got too big and then no more propagation. That was my thesis, and I could prove the instability of that. About this time,
who was the scientific advisor?
My PhD advisor was Joe Keller. Okay, I got my PhD at NYU. Joe Keller is now about 89 years old. He's one of the foremost applied mathematicians in the world. Okay, the Curran Institute was a center for applied mathematics. I was lucky enough to work with Joe Keller. NYU, the Courant Institute, had a birthday symposium for me at my 65th birthday 3 years ago. My mentor, Joe Keller, came and gave a talk. Okay, he was like 86 years old at the time. He talked about the auditory system, all right? He made his money in wave, he made his reputation in wave propagation, perturbation methods for sonar and electromagnetic waves, fluid mechanics. He worked on many different. I saw Joe Keller recently. I was at Stanford, where he's still in America.